Samir also helped Dr. Bali sir to join as presenter.
मैं स्क्रीन ऑन ही अपने स्लाइड ऑन ही कर देता हूँ समीर का। हाँ जी स्मिथ जी करो शुरू, हो गया टाइम।
जी जी सर बिल्कुल, इफ यू आर
हो गया टाइम,
वी आर गुड टू गो सर, वी कैन स्टार्ट।
या
गुड मॉर्निंग, इट्स अ फर्स्ट एंडेवर फ्रॉम पीजीआई एलुमनी एसोसिएशन सोसाइटी एंड दिस इज अ स्मॉल सोसाइटी, अ स्मॉल वर्क व्हिच वी हैव डन, वी ट्राइड इन लास्ट 2-3 इयर्स, नाउ फाइनली इट इज अ रजिस्टर्ड बॉडी एंड वी प्लान टू कैरी आउट सच मीटिंग्स। Not because of the COVID, we have to do it online, but we wanted it to have it. We tried it in India Live also to bring together the all our old members and new members together. And this will continue in future also. Just after the COVID part is over, COVID period is over, we'll have this. We'll have our own rules and regulation are already laid down. We'll have our own accounts, and then we can do. Much more meetings, at least in every national or international meetings, we can have one dinner, one meeting for our members only, where we can get along and we can show what work we are doing to each other. With this, I invite that today's topic is very important because this is one of the topic which is widely discussed in our WhatsApp group of PGI Academics and PGI ICC Web. So I thought that I'll request Wander sir to throw light upon, and this is not a one-way talk. It's just a reciprocation, or it's just like the morning classes we had at PGI, and therefore the experts can drop in any time. They have their mics on. The participants, other participants, can raise their hands or they can communicate through chat. And we'll put their mics on. It is only needed because sometimes multiple mics are on, then they can cause a noise disturbance and the talk is disturbed. That is the only reason. Otherwise, everyone can participate here freely. And I hand over the forum to Dr. Wander sir to speak on post-lockdown, how clinical practice has to be adopted by a cardiologist. Sir.
Well, thank you, Smith. Actually, I must thank you for having put up the PGI Cardiology Alumni Association in place. We really appreciate the efforts of the young group of which you have really taken the lead. And I also thank you for giving me this opportunity to speak on this topic, which has actually become one of the major issues in our life. A very happy Mother's Day to all of you. And I request you to do call up your mothers today if they are not staying with you and wish them all the best in these difficult times. I have never had an opportunity to speak to such an august panel of chairpersons, Dr. Y.C. Chandrasekhar, Professor Yashpal Sharma, our own dear Dr. Mohanan, Dr. Bali, Dr. P.K. Asokan, Nitish. So it's really an honor for me to speak before this very, very august panel on the topic which is affecting all of us. I can say at the outset that I am not an expert on this topic, but I've just collected some of my thoughts on this particular issue, and I'll be sharing those with you. You can chip in between. It's a rather informal talk. And thanks, Smith, for not having any pharma involved in this, so we can make it as informal as we really want to be. As we sit here, all of us today, actually, this COVID-19 has affected already 41 lakh individuals, and 2,80,000 individuals have died all over the world. The UK statistics, actually, it has become the epicenter for this disease, along with Italy, Spain, France, UK, and United States of America. US has almost one third the cases, almost 13 lakh cases today, and 80,000 deaths, or similar one third the total number of deaths. In India, where we stand today, actually, we have about 60,000 cases reported till now, and 2,000 deaths. Although we are all aware and conscious that the number of deaths must be little bit more, and the cases must be actually much more, because it's not easy to hide deaths in a democratic setup like ours. So certainly the deaths would not be much beyond this. We all had the best period of our lives in PGI. I was there in 86, 87 doing my DM, and before that 82 to 85 my MD. And we have such fond memories from that time. We've all gone to different places, created a place for ourselves in the new cities that we have gone to. But today, actually, there is a need for us to restructure our lives to this, what they call, quote unquote, as the new normal, which has erupted in this world. I'll just take you, it might appear that it's been there for a long time. I'll take you through to the actually how all this has shaped in the last 4 months. It's only on 31st of December that China first reported to the WHO. By 3rd and 21st of January, cases were seen in Thailand and in America. And by 30th of January, actually on 20th, they met initially. They did not declare it as an emergency. People feel WHO is to be blamed for the delay that happened. But on 30th of January, they actually, the WHO's global health emergency declaration happened. And on 11th of March, it was declared as a global pandemic. And ever since 25th of March, actually, our worthy Prime Minister declared that we had the lockdown one, then we had the lockdown two in April. And today we are going through the third lockdown. People believe that this is whatever kind of a virus it is. We really don't know. There is a blame game going, which I don't really actually want to go into it. My mother says it is God's way of correcting. The world has gone astray, and probably God is re-correcting. One Shire has very nicely said, Har shakhs gunahgar hai kudrat ke qatal mein. Har shakhs gunahgar hai kudrat ke qatal mein. Ye hawaein yun hi zehreeli nahi hui. So all this that has happened, probably there is an element of corrective element, and we will be able to face this adversity with courage and by being strong. Actually, courage doesn't mean that you are not scared or you are not frightened. It only means that you are afraid of the circumstances, you are taking due precautions, but at the same time, you do the service to the humanity that you ought to do, and that actually should be the principle for all of us, how we move. Couple of words on this virus, which we speak of much more frequently these days than cardiology. And in fact, in the last 1.5 or 2 months, I have read more about coronavirus than about cardiology. I have no hesitation in confessing this. It is actually a RNA virus, just as what we were taught, the Coxsackie, the ecovirus. And it's not a big virus, just has 15 genes as against human beings. We have 30,000 genes in us. It's not even living outside, actually. When it gets into an individual, it starts replicating using the energy of the host. It's not the first time we have this. We had the SARS-CoV-1 in 2002. We have the Middle East respiratory virus infection from the Saudi Arabia in 2012. In both these, less than 8,000 people were affected. So these were actually epidemics, were not a pandemic. And it is this new pandemic, the COVID-19, which has started from Wuhan in Hubei state, which is a big city of China with about 12 crore population. People feel it originated from the bats. But what it has caused today is a COVID-19 disease, which we all know is not so lethal as we actually have become scared of. Almost 80% of these people have a mild kind of a disease, but 14%, 15% of them develop hypoxia. They have dyspnea and they need to be hospitalized. 5% have to be put on ventilators. Data across the world shows half the patients who are put on ventilators, they come out after a prolonged ventilatory period when tracheostomies have to be done in a lot of them. And about 2.3% of them have fatalities. We know fatalities are more in the elderly. I was just reading a report from England, UK actually, which has a collection of 18,000 patients. And the mean age of death there was 80 years. It affects males more, people with diseases like cardiac, hypertension, diabetes. They have more fatalities than the others. But there is also actually a variation in the death rates that we have seen across the world. In Europe, it has been much higher. US about 5.8. We have death rates of about 3.2. In terms of the population, actually, if you look at how much of the population gets fatalities, the death rate in India is 0.8 or 1 or 1.5 per million, which is much less than what it is in US and even less than what it is in Spain. Actually, some people believe we are a land of God. We are a land where there are so many rishis, saints, and possibly we have greater resistance. And even our own Gurbani says, Na o mare na thage jaye, Na o mare na thage jaye, Jiske Ram base man me. So if you have faith in God, obviously you will be saved. But one big factor in our having escaped the fatalities till now is the declaration of the lockdown, which our Prime Minister declared actually when we had less than 500 cases. The Lancet, as usual, is not so kind to the Indian government and gives editorials which are actually negative for us. But this is one act which really is being looked at, and even the WHO has lauded. If we look at actually Dr. Reddy recently in one of the newspapers had actually shown that there are some states which are doing worse than others, Maharashtra, Gujarat, Delhi, and Madhya Pradesh. Somehow Indore has become an epicenter for this. And these are the states where if you look at per million population, what are the deaths rate? And the case fatality rates is another way of looking at it. The case fatality rates in Punjab are about 2.6, whereas the death rates per million population is 0.63. So we are much better off than some of the other countries. But within our country, we have now divided it into the red zone, the orange zone, and the yellow zones. And we have places where the disease is much more than in others. And so we have to actually look at this particular positive factor that we do not have that many fatalities till now. But as the lockdown is going to get released, we might see more and more cases. And so we have to be prepared for the worst, but always keep a positive frame of mind, since that is what is going to take us through this period. Coming to the topic, well, friends, as I said, I am not an expert. Things are changing. The guidelines that were put into place in the initial part of this pandemic have now been changed. And since these are not unprecedented situations, whatever I say is subject to your thoughts. I was just reading, it said that we have to develop a surge capacity in our own hospitals. And this surge capacity has to be developed so that we can handle this unusual, unprecedented circumstance. And this not only has to be in terms of space, you have to alter your hospital's spacing. Staffing is a big problem, is a big issue. You have to rest one third of your staff so that in case, God forbid, case comes positive, the whole team does not get inundated. The supplies that you and I were not used to, like the PPEs, the masks, and all these things, the disinfectants. I'll talk a little bit about these things since we are not used to all this. And I happen to be in the hospital administration, so I am involved in some of these things. And of course, we need to develop our own systems depending upon how big or small a setup you are. Values have to be shared. There has been no other better time than this to have a teamwork and mutual respect with not only your co-doctor workers, but also your nurses and your last three, your help staff, because the healthcare delivery chain is only as strong as the weakest link that you have. And some at times, if you do not take everyone along with you, your weakest chain can remain weak. And we also know that we are learning, we are relearning, because the only predictable thing of this pandemic, friends, has been its unpredictability. And so you have to do things in a trial and error approach. You will all know initially Trump asked for hydroxychloroquine. Our ICMR advised us that we should all take hydroxychloroquine. Last couple of days, there have been some negative trials with hydroxychloroquine. The enthusiasm is much less with that. Lopinavir, ritonavir were initially tried. There was a negative trial in NEJM. At present, actually, the FDA has given the emergency utilization authority for remdesivir and tocilizumab, which is an interleukin-6 inhibitor, along with convalescent plasma. I think these are the... So there are things are changing, actually. And you will have to alter your plans according to these changing situations, because it truly is a warlike situation. And the more we sweat in training, the less would we bleed in the combat. And as the American President Franklin Roosevelt said during the Great Depression, you have to try a method, and if it fails, don't hesitate actually to try another one, because situation is changing, the pattern of disease is changing, the virus is going to replicate and alter its potential to cause lethality. And so, as I said, make protocols of your own, share these protocols with each and every person of your hospital staff. Do not leave anyone. And the online training actually is the way to go about, so that you do not crowd people while you are sharing with each other. This is a good document from the PHFI, which I thought I'll share with you. You can go through this particular document. It will really help you in formulating your own hospital's method. First and foremost, I would say we should all take care of ourselves. Adequate rests after duty, good diet, good sleep, positive frame of mind. These are some of the things which we have to inculcate during these difficult times for ourselves and also for our colleagues. Some new equipments have come, like this infrared thermometer. Most hospitals have now developed, actually, as you can see a poster we have put in Punjabi, one patient is allowed only one relative. So these kind of new posters have come in various hospitals. This is an ingenious method, actually, I developed in our hospital. We have put these plastic, in fact, one of our gynae consultant initially started and then we copied from her. They put these plastic kind of a curtain, and so the patient is not coughing directly into you. So these kind of innovations that suit your own system will have to be developed. All hospitals should have a fever clinic, a triaging, where patients are screened outside. All hospital staff has to be screened. In our hospital, we have a rule that all patients can enter only with face masks, and nobody is allowed to enter without a face mask. When patients come to our OPDs these days, we are spacing them adequately. We are not allowing crowding. We have split our OPDs into a longer period of time. We have shifted actually from our own OPD smaller rooms into the main lobby, which is well ventilated. Windows are open. And part of the advice, actually, what we have innovated in our hospital is we are splitting between in-person consultation and consultation on phone, WhatsApp, so that the patient's interaction with us can be reduced as much as possible. and the human meeting aspect is also taken care of. These kind of people are at higher risk. You all know those who are more than 60 years, males with comorbidities, smokers, obese, and we are not letting them as patients attendants. Only young people have to come as patients attendants so that these individuals do not increase their risk as attendants. As I said initially, the new normal is being defined. Attendance, we have stopped attendance in our hospital because we did not have retina scans, but they are not very expensive. We just found out recently, and retina scan attendances will come up in hospitals. Of course, Aarogya Setu app, all of us have downloaded. As I said, we keep our doors open. Part of our consultation is on the basis of video, and we have a separate entrance in our hospital now for our patients and staff. In fact, for the patients, there is a separate entrance and exit so as to reduce crowding at one place only. We have made our staff realize that in the OPD area, the PPEs can be a PPE grade 1 or 2, whereas patients in the emergency are unknown whether they are COVID positive, COVID negative. A lot of these patients come with pulmonary edemas. So grade 2 or grade 3 PPEs are to be adopted in admitted patients. Well, we have developed our own consent form because patients have to be told that they are at a risk of getting disease from healthcare workers, from other patients, and they have to give a consent that they realize all this and they have been explained. So this is an additional consent form which has come up in a hospital before a patient enters a hospital, besides filling in a form as to where he has come from, does he have fever, any contact. They sign this consent form and then we let them in because we realize that unless they are part of this whole process, we will not be able to manage patients. Well, the workplace, as I said, we have changed. Now there is an issue of ventilation. We have to, air conditioning protocols have to be changed. The Indian Society for Heating, Refrigeration and Air Conditioning Engineers, what they call as ISHRAE, they have given guidelines. They say negative pressure cath labs have to be created. I spoke to our air conditioning people. They are not very easy to create since our hospitals are not designed for negative pressure cath labs and OTs. But what they have easily done is they have increased the amount of fresh air and the number of air circulations. The AHU for the emergency has been separated so that at least that area is away from the rest of the area. So you will have to engineize your own actually methods up to what extent you can do, because this virus is very, very, if I have to use a Punjabi word, it's a very chipku virus. It actually binds to anything and it can live for a longer time in cold environments. So what is detrimental for this virus is heat, humidity and ultraviolet light. So keep in mind, in fact, WHO has given 2 days back that in the open environment, this virus will affect less. So heat, open environment, these are some of the things which we have to use. Hospital disinfection protocol has to come up and it has to be picked up in a very big way. We know warm water now, all cleaning of the hospital has to be with damp mop and has to be with warm water as against the routine water. Refrigerators are a place where this virus can stay and we all keep our insulins in the refrigerators. It is recommended that every week all refrigerators should be defrosted, opened. All ambulances should be opened and their windows should be opened for half an hour to 1 hour every day, because it purports in the closed environment and we have to open up the environment. We need to take our cleaning staff. We have to develop the spraying module. We have to use the healthcare economics is going to be a big factor. Wastage has to be avoided and we have to use floor cleaning with 1% sodium hypochloride. Fumigation has to, we have all been fumigating our labs with hydrogen peroxide 10%, but now we have to use 2.5% hydrogen peroxide for tabletops, doors that are frequently opened, the areas that are you are touching frequently, they have to be sprayed. So these protocols, which you and I have not been looking after, has to be taken care of, because they will impact and affect how long can you deliver your services and keep your associated staff in good health. This three bucket model, all your cleaning staff, the houseman has to realize all detergents are bad for this virus. So initial cleaning with water and surf, and final one with phenyl and sodium hypochloride. So three bucket, or rather four bucket model for cleaning, has to be adopted in your hospital. Every few hours, all hospital surfaces have to be cleaned. The way you and I will be coming to the hospital will obviously change. I have already removed my mobile phone's cover. I don't bring my watch. I don't bring my wallet to the hospital. I keep my stethoscope separate in the hospital. And of course, the things that I carry before I enter my house, I clean them. You will have to develop head covers. You've never worn shoe covers, masks you are all already wearing, impermeable clothes. Not all PPEs have to be the difficult ones. Depending upon the exposure, you can actually develop PPEs region-wise. Patients in the OPD will not require grade 3 or stage 3 PPEs. They will require grade 2 PPEs only. Of course, every person who works in the emergency, who wants to look after sick patients, the donning and doffing protocols have to be developed for your own hospital. This is actually, studs have developed, studs is actually based in Yamunanagar in Haryana, and a close friend of mine was telling me that they have developed lots of these face shields. You can develop face shields in your own hospital, and of course, head covers will have to be worn. We know N95, the All India Institute, has been giving various guidelines. This is a nice guideline by which five masks can be used for 20 days. You keep your mask in the envelope, and every fifth day, the turn of that mask, the N95 mask, comes. So these kind of local cost-effective modalities will have to be developed. A lot of people in high-risk areas will develop a three-ply surgical mask over a N95 mask. We in our hospital feel that the valved masks are harmful because they expose others to the venturi effect of the exhaled air. So we are not allowing the valved masks in our institution. All this is bothering you, I know, because I'm burdening you with a lot of things besides cardiology, but I can tell you a positive frame of mind at this time. So take some respite. Louis Vuitton is going to come up. In fact, my wife was telling me she had a phone call from one of her boutique ladies. She said, I can make a mask, face mask, just as similar to your suits. So these kind of innovations are going to happen. And life is, of course, going to be different. The new normal is going to be different. In US, they developed this rain poncho for the raincoat, actually, that they use for. Because high aerosolization activities are when you nebulize a person, when you are using a BiPAP or a CPAP, or when you are intubating a person, patient is coughing. In fact, it is recommended that even if you're giving a binasal oxygen to your patient, make that patient wear a mask so that the healthcare workers are not at risk. This plexiglass box is nice. It is good for intubation because intubation, in fact, places people at the highest risk. We have been actually innovating in our own hospital.
Welcome back, viewers, and joining us on this broadcast at this hour, Dr. Ashwin Sahani, who's an assistant professor.
Akmita.
For biomedical.
Akmita.
IIT Roper, as well as
Akmita.
Dr. Gupta, who's from the Hero DNC Heart Institute. And in fact, the specialty of these two gentlemen who have worked on a containment box to protect our healthcare workers. Thank you so much, gentlemen, for joining us here on Republic TV. We'll go across to Dr. Ashish Sahani first. This is a very unique kind of containment box that you have, in fact, come up with. If you can take up your full details, how will this really protect or help our healthcare workers who are, in fact, fighting on the front line of this COVID pandemic?
So this is the kind of containment box which we developed our anesthetists so that there is a negative suction applied within it. So these kind of innovations, these kind of things will have to be developed by all of you. Coming to the cardiac, actually, profile of the cardiac changes that happen in this, what people have seen is actually it is now called as the acute COVID-19 cardiovascular syndrome, because we realize that it is not only the cardiac injury, it is not only the cardiac myocarditis which happens. There is also a microvascular microangiopathy, because we realize that microthrombi, in fact, even strokes, large vessel strokes have also been reported to be higher. So whether the heart get involved by a direct viral injury, whether it is a response to the immunological activity or the inflammatory response, what it actually results in is a myocarditis. And about 20 to 25% of these patients have high troponins. And those who have high troponins, their mortality is almost 5 times higher than those with no rise in troponins. And if someone already has an underlying heart disease.
Sir, you have your screen sharing is off now after the TV play.
My screen sharing, Dr. Samit?
Yeah, yes, sir. It is off now. So we are not able to see the slides now.
Okay, I'll just reboot it.
Samir, can you help?
Just 1 minute, I'll do it. We are doing it.
So from the slide that had the TV was.
Just give me a second. Can you see it now? Smith?
Yes, sir, Smith? We can see. Yes, sir, we can see.
Okay, fine, perfect. So I was actually telling you about the troponins. 20% people have high troponins. And those who have high troponins and baseline heart disease, they have almost 5 times higher mortality than individuals who neither have high troponins nor do they have actually baseline heart disease. So we have to actually look at these individuals in a different format, because it's the myocardial injury and myocarditis which is responsible for this rise in troponins. And in the initial part of this pandemic, actually, people thought that all these patients are actually part of the STEMI. Some people, because there are ST elevations seen. But there is a paper from Sripal Bangalore from New York, which has shown that they took 18 patients of acute ST elevation presentation. And they found out that 40% of their patients did not have any coronary artery disease. So a lot of these troponin rises are actually due to myocardial injury and myocarditis. But still, this is a marker of high mortality, high risk. The other marker is, of course, high D-dimers in your patients, because a lot of these patients have microthrombi in the pulmonary circuit. And in fact, you must have seen a lot of people in autopsy data are also showing. So we have arrhythmias. We can have, of course, type 1 or type 2 myocardial infarction and heart failure. So this whole gamut of presentation of acute myocardial infarction, myocarditis, arrhythmias, cardiogenic shock, all these things happen in these patients. And when they come to us in the emergency, actually we are at a loss. So we in our hospital actually have advised our emergency residents that you look at lymphopenia with a much greater significance. Because we know lymphopenia occurs in about 80% of these individuals. It is a marker of higher mortality, and it is associated with a decrease in T cells, especially the CD4 and the CD8 lymphocytes. And we know in aging, there is an immune response weakness. And so consequently, there is a dominance of these mononuclear cells, the macrophages. So besides lymphopenia, we get TROPTs, the troponins, and we do the natriuretic hormones, D-dimers, the ferritin levels. These are some of the things which tell you, raise a suspicion. Of course, X-ray is very important. Some people initially wanted to do CT scans because this peripheral opacification on a CT scan is a marker. But we don't believe in our hospital, since the radiology department is a little bit away from our cardiac center. So our patients have to be transported to a longer distance. But if your patient is going for a CT scan, either way, you must actually get a CT. If patient has to go for some other indication for CT, echoes actually have to be more often portable by the side of the patient and for the shortest period of time. This has been an area of interest. Actually, one of our Indians, Mandeep Mehra, has also published. And this is data from China, which shows that people who are on ACE inhibitors and ARBs, actually the CSI came up with guidelines early. The API also came up with guidelines, that the ICMR did the same. People who are on ACE inhibitors and ARBs, they should not withdraw these drugs because of the fact that they will be, their heart failures will get precipitated. And this particular data shows that death rates are much lower in people who continue to take their ACE inhibitors and ARBs than people who do not take the ACE inhibitors or who stop or who are not on ACE inhibitors or ARBs. Actually, if you look at this virus, it is this spike which lends the hello or the crown name or the corona name to it. And it is this spike which attaches to the ACE receptors. And that is why there was this fear that people who are on ACE blockers or ARBs, there might be an increased risk to these individuals. But it is this S spike, which is also the target for the vaccine development also. So it is this culprit actually, which is bothering us. So how has this pandemic affected our lives? We all know the OPD attendances have come down. Patients are not coming for fear of coming to the hospitals, although doctors are being blamed by some media and some politicians that we are not looking after patients, but actually patients are not ready to come. And this is a world over phenomenon. The Harvard University and Frisia, which is a healthcare technology company, which looks at 5 million outpatient visits by 50,000 providers. What they found was that even in US, there is a 66% decrease in outpatient visits, which are much more in cardiology than in some other branches like obs, gyne or behavioral. Of course, they are much more in ENT, ophthalmology, where of course patient has to be seen more closely. But this is a universal phenomenon. Patients are hesitant to come to the hospital, and so they are staying back home. But this has also raised an opportunity. And in fact, if we look at the US data itself, the virtual visits, which a lot of you and I are doing now, whether it is by phone, by email, by video conferencing or whatever modality. In fact, in mid-February, 0% of the visits in US were virtual visits. But by 15th of April, 30% of visits had been converted to virtual visits. And today, what we actually have is a lot of people are getting telehealth being provided. The government of India has actually given guidelines. There is a consenting issue. If patient gives a call, you do not need to take a consent. But if you are giving a call, a consent has to be taken. There are some HIPAA compliant providers which should only be used. And my personal recommendation to you is, although in US people have been allowed to charge and they are charging, in our country, patients are not yet tuned to this. They have not used to paying on a phone visit. So I would urge upon my colleagues not to indulge in this money business with televisits. Any of these actually portals, the UP Docs, VC, Doxy.me, Zoom for healthcare, Skype for business, Google G Suite, there are so many of them actually you can use and provide services. In our hospital, we give part of the advice on patient has many questions at times to ask. We do that on phone and by other means. Looking at the admitted patients, this is actually a guideline from the government of India. The donning area, a lot of people are making the donning and doffing area next to each other. And I personally feel one of the biggest portal of infection is the doffing area. The doffing area sterilization has to be proper. People have to be taught. it's not the donning area, it's the doffing area which needs to be negative pressure, ventilated, cleaned, sterilized, because it is here that people are taking off. And how this PPEs that you discard, they are going off into the waste buckets, and how they are discarded, that protocol you have to develop in your own hospitals. It's not only for OPD patients. We know even STEMI patients are less. In Austria, there was a report that there was a 30% decrease in STEMIs. US also, actually, on 9th of April, Dr. Garcia reported in JACC that there is a 38% reduction in STEMI activation, even in 9 very high volume centers. And even from Italy, there is a report from the city of Lombardia. There is a 50% decrease in out of hospital cardiac arrest. So patients are staying, they are containing their symptoms. And what we are going to see, friends, is a downstream effect of this. Many more patients will now come to you with heart failure, and there is going to be a significant collateral damage to the society because of this extra fear that has happened to the people. And so the ACC, the CSI actually has developed this CardioSmart public awareness. And we all are urging people that if they have symptoms, they should come to us. There are some issues actually with regards to testing. And we know there are reports hospitals cannot insist on COVID testing. Well, friends, we all joined this profession with altruistic feelings, but certainly these were not suicidal feelings. And we know, we are aware that we have to look after our patients to the best of our capabilities. But still, if there is a RT-PCR, we know RT-PCR has a positivity rate of about 70%. But if RT-PCR is available, patient is going for a very high risk procedure, there is some suspicion of COVID-19, then these people will have to be subjected. We have to know that the RT-PCR starts becoming positive about a week before symptoms come, and it can remain positive for about 3 weeks. The antibody testing has not yet come to our country, but we know IgM rises and then falls back by 6 weeks, but the IgG remains high. And in fact, in New York, I was listening to one of Andrew Cuomo's daily address that he makes. He's the New York governor. They did a study and they found that 20% of New York's grocery shop visitors were testing positive for antibodies. And they have these very effective, with very high sensitivity and specificity, reliability index antibody testing. And what they found was that for any one documented case of COVID-19, there are possibly 10 undocumented. Germany feels there are 50 undocumented cases. So it is this antibody testing which is going to give us a greater insight into what percentage of our population has already got affected. Well, this is actually Government of India's guideline as to what, for IPD patients, what kind of PPEs you should be wearing. So friends, for admitted patients, actually what we have done is we have shared duties, jobs. Part of our rounds are actually on phone, and doctors, nurses, dietitians, residents, what we have done is a clustering of our responsibilities. And in fact, we are a unit with 7 consultants, but we are at present functioning in a single unit format. All our OPD patients are coming under cardiology services. All our admitted patients are coming under the cardiology department. And all of us, me, Dr. Bishop Mohan, Dr. Naved Aslam, Dr. Sheba, Dr. Pupinder, Dr. Abhishek, Dr. Gurpej, Dr. Rohit, we all function as a single unit. And we have separate days. So our previous method of working has been changed. I'm sure a lot of you will be doing that. When we go for rounds, we are not carrying our associates with us. And we are trying to do jobs for each other. The paper has to ultimately give way to iPads. We haven't yet done this in our hospital. But if this pandemic continues for a longer time, we will have to do this. A lot of non-medicos have started teaching us medicine. In fact, Bill Gates has now 2 editorials in the New England Journal of Medicine. He, of course, is contributing enormously towards the vaccine development. And he also feels that the Indian model of single person clinics, they can not only help in patient care, but they can also help fight pandemics. And so there are a lot of things in our Indian system of medicine we should continue. And I would like to end here with a couple of suggestions. Actually, we have to develop protocols for our own hospital. We are all equal in this. Actually, that is, if there is one lesson this pandemic has taught us, is we are all equal. Nurses, doctors, paramedics, the cleaning staff, the security, all have to be on board in terms of the protocols that you develop. We have to change. Adaptability is the word to go. Stress, of course, is there in everyone's mind. We know workforce is inundated with plethora of requirements. And on the rational to emotional scale, this particular scale is tipping towards the emotional side rather than the rational side. So don't lose your temper. No advice is bad. Every advice is good. Seek episodic sanctuary. Take rest and meditate. Even our Gurbani says, Je mushkal hove ati pari, if the difficulty is very big, Hari ko naam khin mein udari, God's name will at least give you respite and end it. So friends, it is a marathon, we know. We have to learn to live with this virus, but we are all sure this too will pass, just as many other challenges that medical field has faced till now. Thank you. I know I have taken a little bit longer time. We have a very august panel, and they can all give their opinions. I don't think I can answer any questions because this is all that I know of about this topic, and you can all give your comments. That will be more valuable. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I think that was very informative, and it has covered almost all aspects that we wanted to know. One thing I'd like to comment is on the consent form, sir. One of my batchmates in UP had a problem where FIR was filed against him, that he became COVID positive, and then he was the one who could spread it.
Smith, so can we change the screen? Can we have all the panelists on the screen? Because I can see YCC.
Yeah. Yeah. Huh? Sameer, please, can you do that?
Can we have? Yeah. Fine. Great.
Hey guys, how are you?
I see.
So that fellow, now in UP, they have designed a different consent form where you do take consent from the patient, that informing you do not have a COVID or you may have a COVID, like that. In addition to that, they have added a line that the doctor may also give you COVID, and therefore you are accepting that and then getting treatment from that doctor, because that there was a FIR launched against that doctor.
I agree with you. Actually, we have already put this in our consent form, but yes. This needs to be.
Yeah. And sir, my query is that how do you generate negative pressure in cath lab? And what is the mechanism? Because we are getting our cath lab installed right now. So can I make changes there where we can have it made more safe?
Well, you can ask your engineers. I ask them whether one of our two labs can be made negative pressure. It's very difficult to make negative pressure actually convert all it, because they're all positive pressure areas. So to make these labs negative pressure, this the ISHRAF, the Indian Society of Refrigerators, they are in touch with the IMA. They are ready to guide actually. So I can post you to them, and you can consult them. But it is very easy for them to increase the air exchanges, to increase the amount of fresh air. That's what they can do. But to turn it into a negative pressure, there is an issue.
Yeah, I think I
then exhaust fan also. Sumit, yes, exhaust fan, air cycles, and separate AHU, and central air conditioning. It can be
the TCG MD has given us a layout of the cath lab. I can send you the plan.
Oh, sure. That will be useful.
Just published.
A question to Dr. Chandra also. Like sir was saying, bedside echoes are to be done more. What is your take? Probably my understanding is that we need not do more echoes than required, than very much needed.
Good morning. So good to see all of you here. Brings back fond memories of PGI. Can you hear me well?
Yeah, very well.
Okay. So, the echo issue is controversial, right? So you want to minimize the exposure as much as you can. I don't know how your COVID wards are set up, but in our COVID wards, the doctors spend a lot of time just with video conferencing. We rarely go inside. We only go for the first visit or somebody getting very sick. Rest all is on video. There's a big screen outside the room and you communicate. Whereas the tech is going to spend, even in a fast echo, maybe 20 minutes or half an hour with the patient. And that's a pretty risky thing. They are near the head end. There have been cases in many universities where echo techs have died. One of my echo tech has been COVID positive and sent home. So you want to do it as rarely as possible and just target it to the selected question. Our elective echoes are still going, but once we start ramping up our hospital, we have a whole new protocol where the patients will come and get a drive-through testing a day before their echo. And if that's negative, then they come next day. When they come in from a separate dedicated entrance and they are all screened at the entrance. They get their temperature checked and then they get a mask. And so they straight go, there's no attendants, there's no relatives. They straight go to the lab. They go to a waiting area where they carry like this restaurant style buzzers. And they are asked to come to the lab only when the lab is ready for them. So nobody is waiting in the outpatient waiting area. And then we do very focused targeted echoes. For all our TEs, we are intubating them. So once they get intubated, then the risk of... the risk of aerosolization becomes less. So those are the things we have changed.
Basically, we in PGI Smith are developing an extended probe.
Can you switch off your microphone?
Chandrasekhar, in PGI were taught patient is turned to the other side, not towards the doctor. But that's how we do echo in our hospital. But people who have the patient facing towards them, at least they have to change. That is another. In our hospital, the transparent curtain that I showed, actually, we have developed a hole in that transparent curtain. Curtain is between the machine and the operator. And the arm goes to the other side, and that's how. I mean, these are some of the things the Kerala people have developed for throat swabs, something like. I mean, these things will come up, I think, over a period of time.
Right. There's a lot of innovation going on. Gurpreet, you showed some of the plexiglass boxes for intubation, and also, like, even in our cafeterias and in our outpatient shops for patients. Everywhere there are these counters now, plexiglass barriers. So there's a lot of innovation going on. I'll just add one point about the positive pressure cath labs. Cath labs are traditionally designed to be positive pressure. And at least in our area, the guideline is don't turn it into a negative pressure lab, because then you're picking up everything from the floor up into the air to you and to the patient, and then it's going up to the roof, right? All our patient care units are negative pressure. All our cath labs are remaining positive pressure. The difference, at least in our system, the engineers can turn on positive, negative pressures with some ductwork and some regulator. So it's possible to do it after the cath lab is built, but it's not generally recommended to go positive pressure unless something has changed very recently. If you have about 24 to 26 air exchanges per hour, you are probably okay. And in our area, we have two cath labs which are COVID dedicated. The rest of the four cath labs are regular cath labs. So the COVID dedicated ones have all the precautions you talked about, donning area, doffing area, everything is separate. And in those, we don't get any equipment out. It's all there. And people who are coming in and out are not contaminating that. And we wait for about an hour between cases if possible. And that's enough air exchanges for it to get a terminal clean. And then we are ready for the next one.
Dr. Ashokan, there is a question that should the televisits be charged or not charged? Now, it's almost 60 days that cardiologists are doing it for free. For how long they can do it for free? There was an issue in Amritsar, but then the issue was settled by good intervention from IMO.
I think it's... Can you hear me?
Your voice is breaking.
Can you hear me now?
Sir, your voice is echoing. Please switch off your speaker. Switch off your speaker. Anyone can take this question.
Mohanan can answer it, I think. Mohanan, what's your thought?
The Indian Medical Association has strongly resented that. But we don't know. And as Gurpreet said, it will be a sudden transition, and maybe we should take time to charge them. Maybe gradually. The Indian Medical Association was not at all happy with the whole concept of e-consultation.
So I probably should add, in the US, the funda is very clear, right? You have delivered a service, so you charge.
Sure.
And what the CMS, which is our reimbursement body, Medicare and Medicaid, how much it pays for the visit, it has now treated a video visit the same as an inpatient, as a face-to-face visit. So you get paid the same amount, which wasn't happening before, but now it does. And it's not going to be a short time. At least my university is a big modeling place for the COVID epidemic, and they think this is going to keep bouncing at least till the end of the year. And so if that happens, the video connect is probably going to be our regular way of consultation.
Yes. So Dr. Mrinal Kanti Das has asked, who will bear the extra expenses, especially in the private hospital that is now coming with COVID care?
Actually, Dr. Das has raised a very important, I just wanted to speak on this before others speak, because cost effectiveness of a hospital, Dr. Yashpal and you are, Smith are working in public sector, but for a private sector, it's going to be an issue actually. Hospitals are one third of their capacity that they are working, and you all know unless the hospitals are 85% to 90% working on their capacity, OPDs are shrunken, so extra expenditures are happening because of the demand of the PPs. It is truly a very stressful situation, and as Chandrasekhar rightly said, this is going to continue for a fairly long time. So economics of the hospital, maybe actually Dr. M.K. Das and Dr. Mohanan can form a committee, which the CSI, I know they've done a great job with ECHO guidelines, with STEMI guidelines. People put in their minds, and maybe some economists, as to how to make things, because this is one other thing which is bothering doctors. We may not be discussing in other panels, but since we are a close friendly group here, this is an issue which bothers most of us.
I think, Dr. Vanya, it is very important, just because we as a medical profession should provide the best services, whether it is through video conferencing or by video calling. In fact, PGI, we started this OPD three weeks back. We have same OPD days, same consultant sitting in office, all senior attendants going to the OPD rooms, and they were getting the calls. Basically, this was a dream project of our beloved President Abdul Kalam. At that time, ISRO and so many things were there. But now the technology has become so wide that even by sitting in the office, you can give the consultation, have their records by WhatsApp, everything, and then you can give a written prescription for follow-up patient. for new patients also with help of doctor there you can communicate. So in the long run we have to go there by this, because this COVID one was also there, we missed at that time. We were treating the patient, there were no tests for viral, MERS also was there, and you know 2012 the mortality used to occur with ARDS when we were intervening this patient very quickly. When we started stabilizing, making them negative, all of them survived, which we published in Indiana Journal also. This is COVID-1 era, MERS era. So basically, if we go intelligently, and of course for private doctors and everything, because this is a survival, if lawyer can take, judges can take, have the consultation from this. So for our profession, for new generations, this profession has to be number one. This I'm telling to the bureaucrats as well as the politician and all, because doctor's profession should not be in that way at such a stage that it becomes neglected one. It should be safer for doctors, best this one for doctors. Regarding Sumit's case, that one case of doctor is positive, we in PGI for working for that pooling by the RT-PCR. If we have all doctors negative, patient negative, attendant negative, and this model will go for all professions, even for the society where they are, everybody is scared whether we go to the barber, saloon, restaurant. So if this model becomes, so whole of the economy will change, and it is very cost effective. In fact, I was delivering a lecture, delivering this by channel. The industry, they said we will commit suicide. And you know, in Dubai, one of the Kerala oil market, very big, he committed suicide. So I just tell, never commit suicide, please. We will give you solution. We will make COVID negative. All staff, all this factory worker, all this. So our endeavor should be to make it cost effective. Fluda test is coming. RT-PCR is there, going cheaper by cheaper. Government is reimbursing. So we as a doctor should innovate in such a way that there should not be, even for myself also, if I am operating, I am positive, it will be my conscience that I will be giving to so many healthcare workers as well as staff. Mixing of COVID positive and negative is very, very wrong. In fact, when this started in COVID, in cath lab and in our seminar in first week of March, before this autopsy findings came, as you know that I'm telling in all conferences, API, this one, cardiogenic shock, endothelial dysfunction, slow flow thrombosis, all our residents know this and all, 2002 onwards, when this was discovered in PGI. So basically, aggressive thromboprophylaxis, thrombolytic, followed by tarofaban. In 99%, there is no need for ACS to immediately intervene. Now we are working on pacemaker. Sir, how the pacemaker can be done? By ivermectin, we can make them negative within 2 weeks, TPI. And when it becomes negative, put the permanent pacemaker. So for cardiologists and all healthcare workers, we have to develop such a common strategy that should be useful worldwide. Because otherwise, cardiologists are at maximum number of, if you see Italy and all, risking their life.
I think Dr. Ashokan wants to say something.
Samir, yeah, Dr. Ashokan. Can you hear me now?
Now,
it's a very important question they raised. That is health resources and economy. Now, two things. Certain areas, I'm talking about India. Certain part of India is badly affected, like say Maharashtra and Chennai and Madhya Pradesh, Gujarat and all. Other areas, the infection loads are not very high. And overall, we don't know what is the number of people, asymptomatic patients or asymptomatic carrier load in our community. So the practice in each state, in each area in each state is different. And we can't have any individual guidelines. We should go by, as you said, go by the guidelines set up by the government and set up by the society. These are the one thing. As Professor Vander said very clearly, we should have our own protocol. And the most important thing is the patient that are coming to the hospitals are mainly because of emergencies, because endemic has put cardiology in lockdown, not because of fear of COVID infection. and not many people are coming to the hospitals. Now we have to depend on telemedicine. When you want to reduce the number of OP loads, we have to reduce the number of elective procedures, and the people are coming to the OP, we have to go for more and more telemedicines. Then we have to charge according to the hospital's policy. This is my point. And second thing is, coming back to the cath lab with negative pressure, is not possible in our setup, because cath lab is most of the places in the ground floor and the first floor. So when you put the cath lab in negative pressure or ICU in negative pressure mode, then the patients are staying above the level may be affected. So more ideally, this should be in an isolation room that should be in the top floor. These are points I want to make it clear.
So Dr. Ashok, the air is vented outside the hospital. So you
outside,
can make,
outside.
Yeah. So yeah. It doesn't affect the other floors.
Basically, if there are two labs.
So my concern is those are staying just above the floor.
It won't matter.
At this time, low-cost Siam for COVID will be more useful rather than doing in the same lab. So if you are having two labs, one dedicated for non-COVID and one CRM, very low cost, in which you can do just any life-saving procedure. Otherwise, try to make them negative by any means. Within 10 days, they will become negative if you treat them aggressively.
So we have Dr. Bali, but he has joined as an audience rather than panel expert. But still, I'll put a question to him. How we expect surge post-COVID to be handled? How it is
we
going
want
to be handled?
Dr. Smith, we want to see
question. And the other question that is being raised by Dr. Ram is how we check vitals when we are doing teleconsultation, and how do we then adjust? How do we check the vitals? That is one question. Dr. Bali, sir, you can unmute your everyone's mic is unmuted. You can unmute and you can join us with putting on your video. Samir, can he?
While he is joining Smith, can I say something?
Sure, sure. Huh?
Bali sure, and Chandrakar actually need to be social distancing more than others, because in our time they used to have one Lambretta, and Bali, Chandrasekhar, and Robin used to drive that scooter. There are some people.
Good memory.
In fact, when I was there, my PhD used to, Dr. Pradhan and all, they used to travel to ITBP.
Yes, maybe Nitish can take the rap. Nitish, I can see Nitish.
Yeah, Nitish is there.
Sorry, sir. Actually, there was an emergency and I told Smith, and unfortunately, just three patients came. Sir, look at the tragedy now, sir. Three patients have come together. One patient is complete heart block. The SR is busy over there, sir. So the second patient came with brachial artery thrombosis. That patient was to be seen by the CTVS surgeon. The CTVS surgeon, some patient has turned positive. So now he was busy with that patient. So now the third patient came. So I had to go. And this is a STEMI patient. And so they're now, everybody is exposed. A CCU, sir, there is one nurse who's turned positive. So there is a problem over there. Our pediatric cardio, sir, and surgical side, they have turned positive. So suddenly manpower is all gone, sir.
Sir, I think then you are the best person who can tell us what to do.
No, I mean, it is a difficult thing. Now they have, in our hospital, they are asking us to contribute to the general pool. So our COVID patients are distributed in two different areas. One is in the specialty ICU block, which is there in our trauma center. And the second one is in the in Jhajjar. So now we have deployed about 11 senior residents and two faculty. They want us to send 20, another 3-4 more. So I don't know how we do not have the resources to do this.
That's a big problem. Actually, now specialties are being asked to send their people for infectious disease area. I know my daughter is doing GI in New York. She has last 1 month, she's been doing duty in infectious disease only there. But in India, with our own loads being there, it's going to be a big issue for all of us.
Yes, sir. It is, sir. My
apprehension. The fellows in training, they are possibly right in the war front, then they are the most vulnerable lot.
Sir, I have one important observation to make around that, and I don't know whether I'll be. I'm just thinking too much. My apprehension is, sir, for the new batch who will join in MD, MS. Mm-hmm. I have an apprehension that we may not have as many takers in all places, because if the parents start feeling that the youngster is going to be exposed as a corona warrior to the front, I feel there might be an issue even in the fresh intake of specialists and super specialists this year.
Nitish, before Absolutely. That, we have to invent in such a way that we have to make doctor safe as well as patient safe. By doing
that, in fact, you see, there was a news saying that 50% of the MBBS guys, students, feel that this is not the right profession for them.
Basically, this is an opportunity, Dr. Mohanan. This is an opportunity for the cardiologist to have the number one, because this pathophysiology of this disease has come, thrombosis, which is in the domain of cardiologists. And this was being treated by the medicine and anesthesia people, where the wrong happened. And there was no need of ventilator. Now you are reading by the ministry also. If the patient myocardial protection should have been given, and thrombolysis, and maybe 2B3A, which paper we have published in Indian Heart Journal at the time of. So that should be number one. We have published in BMJ also. So that also should be there. We are trying to convey to the whole globe, even regionally, even webinar, even our seminars. Now this is a platform of our PGI cardiology alumni, which will go in a long way to save the patients and bring the cardiologist profession to number one with 100% safety, not only for cardiologists, for other professions also.
I mean, one thing, Sunil, I wanted to talk is that now when we restart after the lockdown, I think it will be a collaboration with the between the regional public health system is one of the things that we have to be taking into account, because we generally cardiologists are little reluctant to involve with the public
health department.
But then that is something which we should be doing when we restart our work.
Yes, sir.
When we'll be having less number of patients, we will be having a lot of time to think, research, innovate. So that is an advantage. Basically, what was there in PGI, so much workload. Every time, 24 hours into 7, you are busy with the patient. Now we are getting time. And really, our previous work which has been done.
So, can I ask one question to Nitin, Dr. Nitin?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Dr. Nitin, in your place, do you divide a team into manage COVID and non-COVID patients?
Yes, sir.
Separate team, or the same team is managing both the cases?
Three teams. Definite COVID, team for suspected COVID, one team for non-COVID. Separate non-COVID team for screening. Screening team is separate.
That means you need to have more manpower to manage this.
Yes, sir. But we have divided
and
the hospital.
You should also have more PPEs. So do you have that much of PPEs here?
Sir, our ICU, there is no PPE problem. In the COVID suspect area also, there is no PPE problem. In the non-COVID area, the problem is there are some patients who escape the net. And therefore, what we have done is in non-COVID areas also, we have two zones. One zone is for definite non-COVID. One zone is suspected non-COVID.
Suspected COVID patients, suppose comes with a STEMI, what's your protocol? You admit the patient the same? ICU or separate isolation?
Sir, presently our protocol is if a person comes with STEMI or NSTEMI, we try to get a COVID test. Till now, we have been able to do it in practically everybody. Previously, we could not, but now practically everybody is agreeing to do the test. So, till that person gets a test, he's thrombolyzed and treated. and the until the test result comes, he goes to a suspected COVID ward. Once he comes out from the suspected COVID ward, he comes to cardiology ward, which is a non-COVID area. But within our own non-COVID area, we have realized that sometimes we miss things and patients turn out to be positive later. So if we feel strongly that there are clinical features, still suspect that the first test is negative, we keep the patient in a probable non-COVID area where we are treating as a COVID suspect, and then we discharge from there itself.
Nitish and Chandrasekhar both, what is your plan? Because we know RT-PCR is positive 70%. So they are saying that's second right. negative. What is your schedule regarding second negative? What's the protocol?
Go ahead, Nitish.
Sir, for us, sir, we have not had this opportunity to do a second COVID test so far. And in fact, what we have done, we have done only two or three in the entire hospital, and I don't think so. They have turned out to be positive.
Dr. Nitish, we are doing second COVID test. After that also, we are keeping the patient separate. After two COVID negative, I have sent to you the final diagnosis, what we should write in the cardiology now. Two COVID negative, you have to take to the cath lab and to your CCU. This should be 100%.
Sir, but unfortunately, they don't have adequate kits, sir.
Dr. Nitish, there was problem here also, unfortunately. But as a cardiologist, we put our foot down that if the same thing is repeated, COVID plus non-COVID mix, because cardiac post of patient, they are at higher risk, and that there will be line of mortality in the CCU. Nobody can stop that.
Can I raise a very important issue here? Suppose the patient is asymptomatic, coming with STEMI, and they want to take up the case to the cath lab. And do you have to do RT-PCR in this case?
Or yes.
Is it necessary? Yes, because yes. Patient is otherwise asymptomatic, except for STEMI.
80% STEMI. Of the patients, they are asymptomatic and come with just MI, inferior wall and lateral wall, or any palpitation because of myopericarditis. There is no involvement. Every case.
Can we put this patient in isolation ICU? And discharge the case, because anyway, a patient is asymptomatic. And where do you want to check for RT-PCR? This is my question.
If there is a patient is low risk or something, you can discharge. But still, when the patient has come to this, this can be a part of surveillance also. Because patient on the road can get the RT-PCR, and patient and doctor in the hospital cannot get the RT-PCR. How it can be? These two logics should be considered.
Sir, allow me to interrupt. There is a voting also, which is, you can see in the bottom, there is a vote for should the consultation should be paid or not. So you can put your weights for audience also, that they can put their weights. Okay. We have 108 participants, so they can, I see only 11 votes so far. So we can, you can
but put
your
vote weight. But
This is totally against what Dr. Warner has suggested. Everyone wants that the teleconsultation should be paid.
I just support the Ashokan's comment. We have a dual responsibility. One, of course, is to treat the patient. But the most possibly important is to protect ourselves from getting the disease. So I think that is very, very important. And we better be careful.
Yeah, the thing is, according to norms, whatsoever government, because government has to make it.
Now, see, these things are changing. Government is changing the policies. Now, government wants to discharge the patient, is given clear-cut instruction, discharge the patient if patient is asymptomatic without testing for RT-PCR. That's why I raised this question.
The thing is,
we are discharging the patient, whether it's negative or positive. So, if patient comes with STEMI, and there is no COVID symptom.
Listen. The government is being advised by some doctors. So some doctors should be wiser enough for safety of other doctors. Government doesn't know anything, because government is not a scientist or doctor. Some doctors are advising them. So that should be kept in mind.
Dr.
Chandra wanted to say something.
Our situation, we don't have the option of thrombolysis. So the ACC and everybody else has said the standard of care is still PCI. Okay. So So we just go and do take all the precautions and go and do the primary PCR just like usual, and not worry about the RT-PCR. And in the people where we do the RT-PCR, it takes many hours to get it. It's not like we can, there's a rapid test which we can get in 20 minutes, but it's not as accurate as the full RT-PCR. So we just send it when possible and don't wait for it.
So what proportion of your patients like this who are having just STEMI but do not have any other signs to suggest a coexisting infection have turned out to be positive?
Not very later. Often. Not very that's often.
Right. That's right.
Dr. Vander, the all guidelines are changing. Thrombolysis is becoming number one. Number two, even in primary PCI, if you see all patients with infection and comorbid diseases were excluded. The thing is, on the line of primary PCI, if we say that we are taking patient with pneumonia on the cath lab with 100% mortality and mortality of others, it's not justified at this time. We have to correct it, which PGI is doing for the last 15 years. And PGI is publishing papers with 7% mortality, including cardiogenic shock. Least mortality of cardiogenic shock, all our PGI alumni, which have passed from 2002 onwards, they know it, and they're, those who have country in this alumni meet also, they know that those they have done thesis and all 1,000 patient data, we are now publishing that. There will be a lot of which will be in the interest of line of ACC. We should not, because we can write a letter to the.
So the questions from audience is exhausted. So we can close anytime whenever your comments are over, sir.
Yeah, basically, at this
You can decide on that, because otherwise people will start talking. They will never end.
So we'll have it another
time. Regarding taking the patient, STEMI patient for primary. I think Professor Chandrasekhar said they're taking all patients for primary. My question is, suppose patient with pneumonia or cytokine storm, so do you take such patients or do you just avoid it? Because anyway, patient's outcome depends upon the infection. So, right. And pulmonary involvement.
Right.
Do you discriminate that?
Correct. So that's still a clinical judgment, right? People on ventilators have 80% mortality, right? They are a very sick group. So taking them to the lab is not the first choice there, right? So we all make the same decisions whether doing a primary PCI is worth it or not, correct? So I'm talking about the clean patient who has symptoms, but a STEMI. Somebody in the ICU on a ventilator, renal failure, strokes, thrombosis, pulmonary embolism. We just use the clinical judgment and don't take them to the lab. So
my last question is regarding HCQ, hydroxychloroquine. Yeah. Do you give a prophylactic dose for patients working in a cath lab dealing with COVID, workers?
No.
In US,
what is your practice in your area?
So I
would like to know the opinion from the others and the experts regarding HCQ.
No, sir. HCQ, we are not using routinely as prophylaxis in everybody, sir. Hello.
I think the ICMR has been.
ICMR.
We follow the ICMR guidelines.
Yeah, basically, HCQ should be given. Only thing is with prescription of cardiologist and measuring the QT interval. Basically, QT interval and all scoring system should be done. Secondly, one should always keep in mind that all drugs, ivermectin, whatsoever are coming, one should try that. Because this is, as Dr. Vander has already said, that this is a time of war. We should try and get the best result and make the patient negative as soon as possible so that patient is fit for, as I've already said, analyze. All of you sit together and primary PCI, shock registry, everything you read today only, the patients which were having pneumonia, sepsis, viral, comorbid disease, all they were excluded. When the patient is having any viral illness or doctor is having viral illness, he should not be done the mortality. Otherwise, he will spread the infection to the patient, or he will get the infection from the patient and to the healthcare workers with 100% mortality, 90% mortality. That's what I'm asking. I'm telling that Italy, this one, UK, even USA webinar, that don't mix COVID and non-COVID. Never intervene in COVID if it is absolutely necessary. That will be only 0.1%, 1%.
Sir, it is a very fruitful discussion, and probably the so many things are in hand and so many things are unknown. Probably this discussion would go on, but I think we should call it a day. And Dr. Sarachandra is requested that he'll be telling us about the topic and the speakers for the next meeting, and probably we plan it on next Sunday, and the timing may be changed so suited to Dr. Chandra and others' participation. I thank Dr. participants and the speaker Wanda sir for excellent discussion, and I hope this goes on.
Gurpreet is a very good
show. Dr. Wanda is already very good speaker. Very humble soul.
Thank you for having made it such a neat panel, and thanks. Good to see you again.
Right.
Take care. Bye.
Bye, sir.
Thank you.
Lovely.
Nitish, bye.
Yes.